So if you remember this result, we were looking at this inverse of 1 plus x. We developed it by using this trick of the partial sum into this series, so-called power series. It's an infinite sum. I could write the generic term like this. If it's an even power, it becomes square, and if it's an odd power, then we've got the minus sign. So that's the generic term over there. It's very nice because we've got something which in principle is complicated, the inverse function, which is displaced like this. So it's infinite at x equal minus 1, which is the asymptote, and then we've got complicated behavior like that. That's our function, 1 plus x. And this complicated function, which even has divergences, we can write as simple, something simple, which is basically an infinite polynomial. The fact that it's infinite, we shouldn't worry too much about this, because when the thing converges, especially for small values of the variable, then the high power terms becomes negligible, and then we can get this nice approximation that 1 over 1 plus x is basically 1 minus epsilon, if I've got a small number epsilon there. So that's our infinite sum. That's the good way to think about this. Very good. And from this, we can extend, we can generalize the idea to other results that are similar. Things like this, for instance. If I take for my x here, let's take x, we will replace it into minus x. So the minus minus x become plus x. Plus minus x squared remains square. Minus x cubed is minus 1 cubed, that's plus. And x cubed. Then we've got the fourth power. So you see that clearly the generic term becomes xk. So that's a very simple infinite polynomial. That's the sum of the kth power, successive kth power. That's 1 divided by 1 minus x, which becomes infinite this time at 1. So that's our function. Okay. You see how these two functions, this one and this one, they have these different power series. That's one way to generalize the result. We could also do things like this, for instance. This one is important. We said it has no divergence on the real axis. This is the Lorentzian. Let's start to draw with colors. Otherwise, it would be a bit sad. That's this Lorentzian function. And this one, we can similarly obtain it from the previous result by, which is this one, for instance, by replacing x everywhere by x squared. If we do this substitution, we see that we get, so it would be 1 minus x becomes x squared, plus x squared becomes x fourth, minus x3 becomes x6, so on and so forth. You see the thing here? Yeah? That's the Taylor expansion for this function. We could even use nice tricks. I will show you a couple of them that are really useful, so it's nice to see them already. If you've got a generic power series, so that's the generic power series, where k goes from 0 to infinity. It's generic because it's defined in terms of these coefficients, alpha k. You see that you can get alpha k equal 1, or alpha k equal minus 1 to the power of k, for these various series that we have seen so far. The alpha k equal 1 is 1 minus x, and the one that alternates is 1 plus x. So if you've got such a power series that gives us a function f of x, well, as long as this series converges, we can do things like take the derivative, for instance. So we take the derivative here is equal to the derivative of this function. And the derivative of a sum, well, it's an infinite sum, so there is a trick, yeah? And we remain to demonstrate this exactly, which is something you do next year when you look at the power series in more detail and things like the radius of convergence. But still, accept it like as a working trick, as a rule of thumb that is okay for SVCs to use. A finite sum, when we have the derivative, we can bring the derivative inside the sum, okay? Which means we can put this parenthesis like this. That's what it means to bring the derivative inside. Okay, the sum of the derivative is the derivative of the sum. And this is a constant, by definition. You've got some example there. So if we take the derivative of this, this is the derivative of a monomial. We all know how to differentiate xk. Is kx k minus 1. That gives us, therefore, k alpha k. That's a new constant, xk minus 1. So let's have a look at the particular case here, for instance. 1 over 1 minus x, the derivative is minus u prime, so that's a plus, because I got the minus here, divided by the square of the denominator. Yeah, here I'm using 1 over u, where u is a function, is minus u prime over u square. U prime, you see that if it's 1 minus x, u, then u prime is minus, so let's cancel this minus here, and u prime, it's a square here, u square is 1 minus x square. So this one, that's different from what we have seen so far, because the parenthesis is somewhere else. See, the parenthesis is not here. That's important where we put the parenthesis. We can easily find the power series by looking at the power series of this quantity. Let's take a different color. The power series from 1 minus x, I will write it in green here. 1 minus x is 1 plus x squared plus x cubed, that's the easy one. So if we differentiate term by term as we do here, that gives us 1 becomes 0, x becomes 1, x squared becomes 2x, x cubed becomes 3x squared, so on and so forth. So that's a new power series. I could put this into a red box. That gives us the power series for 1 over 1 minus x, everybody squared. That's a trick to compute this power series. And we could look at other tricks. For instance, I will show you this one because it's also very nice. Just the same as we've got the derivative of the sum is the sum of the derivative. The same trick works for the integral. So integral, we should be careful because we haven't seen yet as part of this lecture, we haven't considered the definition or the use of the integral. But I'll assume that you've seen them already before in your previous education. If it's not the case, well, don't worry, we will look at the integration in due course, starting actually next lecture. The point is, for now, you can see the integral as the reverse operation of the derivative. Yeah? If you differentiate from f, you go to f prime. Well, integrating f prime, you go back to f. So that's kind of the opposite. Anyway, the point is that the integral, just like the derivative, is a linear operation, which means that it permutes with the sum. The integral of the sum is the sum of the integral. So we can put it like this. And then it's something which is also very well known, very famous. The integral of the kth power is 1 over k plus 1 x k plus 1. This you can check it by what I just told you. We'll take a redder shade of red. If we take the derivative of this, we should come back on the initial starting point, the function that we are integrating. Indeed, if we differentiate, this goes down, it will cancel with this, and we lower the degree of the polynomial, so that's xk. You see, that's this quantity. Okay, so that's how we integrate. Very good. So let's look at it, if you want, with this particular case. We'll take 1 over 1 plus x squared that we have seen here. If you remember, is this quantity. We can actually copy it. That means we don't have to write. I put it there. Okay, and we integrate. Let me remove the things that are too much. We will integrate this dx, knowing that the derivative of the arctangent, that's the result we obtained last lecture, the derivative of the arctangent is precisely this quantity. Yeah, which means if we integrate, we've got the other way around, this is the arctangent. Okay, so now if we integrate this, which is easy, we apply this rule, we will obtain the power series of the arctangent. So let's do it. The integral of 1 is x minus 1 third of x cubed plus 1 fourth of x, that's 4 here. So that's 1 fifth of x 5 minus 1 seventh of x 7, so on and so forth. Okay, let me write the 5 more clearly. And that gives us the power series of the arctangent. So we could also put it in the red box. So you see, by using tricks or relationships that we know, we can compute very easily, straightforwardly, power series for new functions. Actually, I can't resist here to give you one particular case because it's very famous. It's known as the Leibniz formula for pi. Leibniz is this guy. Not the friend, but kind of not even competitor, it's an acquaintance of Newton's. So the arctangent of 1, by definition, is pi over 4. Why? Pi over 4, if pi is 180 degrees, pi over 4 is 1, 2, 3, 4. That's this quantity. Yeah, that's one that we need to repeat four times to arrive to 180 degrees. And the tangent, you remember, the tangent is this quantity, the tangent. This is the sine over the cosine. It's equal to 1 when we are here at 45 degrees. Yeah, the sine is equal to the cosine. Square root of 2 over 2 in this case. So if the tangent of 45 degrees, which is pi over 4, is 1, then the arctangent of 1 is undoing the reverse operation, is pi over 4. So if we substitute this here, we've got that arctangent of 1 is equal to pi over 4 is equal to 1 minus 1 cubed times 1 cubed plus 1 fifth times 1 to the 5 minus 1 seventh. So all the x disappear. Yeah. So we've got this quantity. So that's the Leibniz rule for the expansion of pi. It's a very famous result. You can check it. You take 1, you subtract 1 half, you add 1 fifth, you subtract 1 seventh, you add 1 ninth, you subtract 1 eleventh, you add 1 thirteenth, so on and so forth. You will get increasingly equals 2 pi divided by 4. So it's all very nice, but so far it's just a collection of tricks. So it's kind of the way that Euler was doing his mathematics, by using very clever and very beautiful tricks. Yeah. But we'd be more interested to know if whatever a function I give you, a function like this, on some given domain, yeah, could we similarly get a power series for this function? Is there a way to do it systematically without having to find a very clever trick? Well, there is, and this is the topic of this lecture. This is known as the Taylor expansion. And I will show you the result first, and then we will apply it and demonstrate it, prove it, because it's a math lecture, and we are going to use it. So let's first state the Taylor expansion theorem, or the Taylor theorem. We are taking a point I will call A, we could call it X naught or whatever, I'll call it A here. We can, around this point, so we are making the expansion around this point A, we can obtain construction of the function f, which is in red here, by successive calculation of the derivative. So the first order term is like this, that's f prime at a x minus a. That's the first order term. And already this is familiar, this should be familiar, because if I rewrite this expression, there is more to come, it's an infinite series, but so far if we look at this, I reorganize the term, you see that we've got f of x minus f of a, I divide by x minus a, this gives me f prime of a. And this should remind you of the definition of the derivative. Using different notation, where x minus a is a epsilon, so we should need to change variable, and take the limit, okay? Take the limit, because this is only an approximation. So this is the first order approximation of the Taylor expansion, gives you this concept of derivative. If we go to the next order, so I will now actually copy this below, and we carry on. I copy it here. Okay. We think we are winning time, but okay. The next order term, I will write it below. It will require the second order derivative. We take the square of this and we divide by 2 here. The third order corrections. So I could write it like this with 3 primes, but we'll soon get tired to do this. So instead of primes, we put in parentheses the order of the derivative, evaluated at our point A, around which we're making expansion, and I divide by 3 factorial. So actually, this is a factorial. Here you could say that this is divided by 0 factorial, which is 1. Here there is 1, and here there is x minus a to the power of 0. So here it's x minus a to the power of 3. So the generic term you can see is the kth order derivative at the point a divided by k factorial x minus a to the power of k. And we carry on like this forever. So this is called the Taylor expansion. Actually, there is a very particular case of this Taylor expansion, which is called the Maclaurin series, named after Maclaurin, who was some kind of prodigy, a polymath, who did who derived this expression, but without looking at any particular point, looking at the one which is the most important, probably. So actually, often when we speak of Taylor expansion, we really mean Maclaurin expansion, is when we take f of a equals 0. Okay, so I will go to the sum directly, it's an infinite sum, k equals 0, so that's the kth derivative. So the zeroth derivative is the function itself, the first order derivative is the one that will not like this. Evaluated at 0, Maclaurin divided by k factorial xk, x minus 0, so xk. Maclaurin expansion in a red box. Very good. So let's look at examples of this before we demonstrate it. We look at one which is famous, useful, a function that we now know very well, very familiar function, the sine of x. We are going to look at the Maclaurin, so k a equals 0, expansion around 0, around this point, of this function. So the sine is something like this, right? And the sine, it carries on forever, it oscillates forever. So this is a very strange statement that we are making, because we are saying that this we can write as an infinite polynomial. Yeah, which looks very strange, because the polynomials are very simple. They are doing like this, or like this, or like this. They are curving more and more. Yeah? So how can it be that adding all these things, we will reconstruct a sine function over the entire domain? Yeah? However far we go in x, by summing sufficient number of monomials, making a polynomial large enough, we can make a function that oscillates forever. It's kind of crazy. Yeah? But let's check how this formula would work. The sine is a nice function, because we know that the derivative of the sine, so we start with the sine, the derivative of the sine is the cos, the second order derivative is the derivative of the derivative, which is the cos, derivative of the cos is minus sine, so we come back to the sine, yeah? So that's the zeroth order, that's the first order, that's the second order, the third order is minus sine, so that will bring us to minus cos. Then the fourth order will be minus minus, because we are differentiating the cos is plus, so we come back to the sine. And after 4, we are back at the beginning. So that will be, again, now we can copy cos minus sine minus cos sine. And we carry on. Cos can copy this forever. Okay? So let's look at our formula. If it's correct, it tells us that this is, from k equals 0 to infinity, the derivative of the sine, so the kth order derivative of the sine evaluated as 0. So we have to evaluate which function. The functions that we see are the sine and the cos, always the same function, sine, cos, the sine change, the sine like this, the sine change, yeah? But otherwise it's cos and sine, cosine and sine. I don't know if there is a difference in pronunciation between this sign and this sign. Maybe there is, I don't know. I don't appreciate it, and I certainly cannot formulate it. So divided by k factorial xk. So let's go. First order derivative, so let me remind you, on the trigonometric circle, 0 is this point, the sine of 0 is 0, the cosine of 0 is 1, and then we will take plus minus. So plus minus of sine will doesn't matter, but plus cos 0 will bring us to plus cos minus 1. So the first order term is sine. Sine at 0 is 0. So this term cancel. I will put a 0. Plus the cosine at 0 is 1 divided by 1 factorial x. So that's the first term of the expansion. Then we'll go to the sine, which is 0. So I put a 0. Then we go to minus. So here I have to put a minus. Minus, we are at the third order term. So that will be x cubed divided by 3 factorial. Then we've got 0. Then we've got plus here. That's the fifth order term. So that's x5 divided by 5 factorial. Then we've got 0. Then we've got that 0 for the sine. And we've got this term, which is the seventh one. So that's minus x7 divided by 7 factorial. And this we carry on forever. So the generic term you see is minus 1, we need to keep only the odd powers, yeah? Here it's 1, we keep only the odd powers. So odd, it means it's the form 2k plus 1. Then that's the power itself, 2k plus 1 divided by 2k plus 1 factorial. You can see that indeed we've got, let's change the color, we've got the same number here than here, yeah? So it's the same number here than here. And this is to make it odd. So we've got this result by applying this formula that the sine of x, that's the Maclaurin series of the sine, is the infinite sum of minus 1, 2k plus 1, x, 2k plus 1, divided by 2k plus 1 factorial. In physics, we are often concerned by the leading order term. So the leading order term is x. Is it the case? Let's plot our sign again. So I will do it like this. That's the sine of x. The leading order term is, according to this result, that's x. X. It is the case. Yeah. If we zoom enough, you see that my leading order term. These two things, maybe I can make these corrections. Yeah, I can. Yeah, these two things, they intersect the axis. Yeah, if I would be accurate in my drawing, if I zoom now, you see that the red, this is the sine, and the green, the tangent, the line, they are working. The next order term is minus because of this minus, the third order term, minus on the cosine, the first time the cosine appear, not red because I used already, so purple. So it's minus x3 divided by 6, 3 factorial. So you see that indeed, if I limit to the first order correction, the first order term, which is x, my sign, which is good for small value, then it becomes too big. At this point here, I'm well above. The sign should never be larger than 1, never be smaller than minus 1. You see that the x, of course, grows forever. So I have to curb this by adding the correction, which is the x cubed. So that would bring us to something like this. And the x cubed then would be negative like this. Yeah, so we've got minus x cubed, it will be something like this. Okay, so it will be better for this region, now we are better, but at some point, actually you could say that it's qualitatively better there as well, yeah, because we are closer there from the real value, which is here, okay, than there, at least we are between minus 1 and 1. But there is a point where again we become catastrophically wrong, because this is outside the possible domain of the sign. So we need to go to the next order term, which requires a different color, and that's x5 over 125 factorial, which indeed will bring us back. So it will do something like this, and then we will diverge above. So it starts to be messy. Whenever I put the corrections to the fifth order, I always make a mess. Have a look at the real solution, which I put now on the screen. And here you see, so let's look at it as plotted beautifully by the computer. We got this very beautiful reconstruction of the oscillation of the sine by adding increasing powers of monomials, yeah, various powers. So we are making a bigger and bigger polynomial, and this polynomial becomes this beautiful sine function. So there is a very powerful idea here, which is to represent complicated function, like a sine function that oscillates, in terms of something simple, algebraically simple, the sum of monomial, of which we rescale the coefficient. So the question, this Taylor polynomial, it tells us how to find this constant, this coefficient that multiplies our powers, that rescales our powers. And this is given by this Taylor formula. The alpha k of our series is like this. It's very interesting because you see how we bring a non-local result, like the sine wave everywhere, it oscillates till minus infinity to plus infinity, by looking at the derivative of the function at one point, for Maclaurin around zero. If I know the order of all other derivatives at zero, I know the behavior of the function everywhere. So that's linking a local property, derivative of arbitrary order at zero, local, because it's at one point, to the non-local property, which means very far from where we are. So it's a very beautiful result, and it's a very nice property, very strong property of so-called analytic functions. A function is analytic if we can write it like this as a sum of, as a power series, as a big polynomial. It's very powerful because it's linking like this the local property of the function to its entire domain. Okay, I'll conclude with one last example because it's something which is beautiful that will link with some algebraic result that you have seen before, this expansion, where we deal so far with alpha was integer. So now we'll not take alpha as integer, we'll take the general case. Or something bad happened there. We'll take the general case where alpha is real. Okay? Then in this case, by applying Taylor's formula, I let you check that we can obtain the result that you already know. The only difference, so that's the binomial expansion, we will use this binomial coefficient, like this, k in alpha. We've got 1 to the power of alpha minus k, but so the power of 1 times 1 multiplied by any number of itself is always 1, so we don't need to put it. Here we've got alpha k. Okay, k is an integer here because it's in the sum. So the difference, I will put in red difference, is that it goes to infinity. So it's not the finite sum as before when alpha was integer. Now that alpha is real, it makes it a power series, an infinite series. So it's a very beautiful link between finite sum and infinite series. And we need to define now these things because we have defined this binomial coefficient from combinatoric arguments using Pascal's triangle. Here, when alpha is real, we have to define what it is. So you can demonstrate by applying this Taylor formula, do it as an exercise, that we can provide, well, they are defined like this. If I'm not mistaken, that's the definition of the so-called generalized binomial coefficient. You can check in particular that if alpha is n, this product, so it's the same use here, the same definition for the product rather than the times, rather than the sum, sorry. If you have a sum, this becomes a plus, so with this, this becomes a product. Otherwise, it's the same, yeah, we're making the product of these things with k, the dummy index. If alpha is an integer, you can check that this is a finite product. Otherwise, it becomes, it's always a finite product because n is always, that's n here. There is something which was wrong, that's n. Okay, this is the k that is always finite. So that will always be a finite product, but it becomes, it truncates if alpha becomes integer. It self-truncates so that this infinite sum becomes finite. Have a look at this generalized formula. So for k that are integer, you should see that you recover the Newton or the familiar binomial formula that you have already seen. And look as well at k's like alpha equal 1 half or minus 1 half. And check it with the things that you have already demonstrated above using tricks. Yeah, using tricks like this. Okay, here you see some tricks. This case, for instance, or the square, or the thing like this. Or check it with the if it's not the case, because 1 half is the square root, so we didn't see these tricks, maybe we it are not so straightforward. Check it with the general Taylor formula, because you should know how to differentiate that. So now let's come back to the general thing. We've seen applications of this generic Taylor theorem. Now we are going to demonstrate it. So I'll state it again. The Taylor theorem, and I will be more accurate. I will write it like this. I will say that it's a so-called Taylor polynomial, like this. So it's a polynomial that I will define below, Taylor polynomial of order k plus a remaining term. So the remaining term, I will write it like this, hk of x minus a to the power of k, where the Taylor polynomial P of k by definition, so this is the one we have seen before, but it stops there, it stops at this k. So here I need to take a dummy index which is not k because now my k is fixed there. So that's the nth order derivative at a, if you are making the Taylor expansion around a, divided by l factorial x minus a to the power of l. Okay, that's the definition of the Taylor polynomial. So in particular, now this is a real polynomial. Means it's finite, there is a finite number of terms, namely k plus 1, don't forget the 0. Okay, so what it tells us is that our function can be decomposed into a polynomial to order k, and then if you want to stop at some point, because we don't want an infinite series, we want to stop, well, we know that what we have is something, h of k, which we need to define as well. We need to define, because otherwise, I mean, it's easy to define h of k. If we don't give property of h of k, the thing is trivial, the statement. It could be whatever. It's completely empty. If we don't characterize h of k, I just wrote a tautology. I wrote something and then I correct it back. So there is no result here. There is no result. Let's write h of k. H of k, by definition, if I rearrange this expression, that's my function minus my Taylor polynomial divided by this term, which is x minus a k. Yeah, that's the definition of f of k, where the polynomial is defined like this, and then, and I need to make a statement on this, hk of x is such that the limit when x goes to a of hk of x is equal to 0. So that's what we have to prove. We have to prove that h of k, which is defined like this, is such that the limit goes to 0. If it doesn't go to 0, then they, again, that's a tautology, that's trivial, there's no statement. Yeah, we are just saying that a function can be written at whatever I want, plus the, we undo this, and that's it. Yes, it's completely vacuous. But now, if I insist that this something, a Taylor polynomial, press h of k, which has the property that this goes to zero like this, its limit is zero, then we are making a very important statement. What is the statement we are making? We are saying that this is the function, this is the bulk of the function, is defined by this polynomial, so that's a good approximation, because at this order k, this term is negligible. Yeah, the last term here is of order k. In the definition of this polynomial, you see that we've got this x minus l to the power of k. That's the last term. And then the over term, like this, is negligible as compared to this x minus a k. Okay? It means that this is very small as compared to this. So again, that means, this Taylor theorem, it means that a function f is R Taylor theorem plus something very small. That's what it means. Okay? Take the time to understand this. It's very important. That what it means to have the limit of this hk being equal to zero. You can pause the video and think about it. If it's clear enough already, we are now going to demonstrate it. So we need to demonstrate, that's what we need to prove. Yeah? We have to show that, what is in the box. To demonstrate that this limit is equal to zero, we need as well to when we define h of k, we should add as well that this is defined like this, if x is different of a, yeah, then it's well defined. If it's equal to a, we cannot define it like this because I divided by zero. Yeah, to define h like this, what I did is I used this expression, I put this on the other side, I divided by this, and that gives me h of k. But I could divide by this if this term is non-zero. If this term is zero, we cannot divide by zero. So the way that we define this quantity, we say that it's like this, I will put this below. That's the property of our quantity. I will move it below. We need to say what happens if x equal a. What happens if x equal a? We'll say that function is equal to zero in this case, which is what we want, right? We want that this term is very small, so if we are it exactly, if we are on the point around which we make the expansion, it should be that this correction, the way that we make the mistake, is zero. You can check that indeed, if we put x equal a in our polynomial, the first term, let's expand our polynomial. If it's difficult for you to remember what it is, I will copy it there, and we will expand it. I copy my polynomial there. Let me remove the things that are not needed. All this is not needed. So pk of x, the first order term, l equals 0, is f, the 0 of derivative is the function itself, evaluated at a, divided by 0 factorial, which is 1, multiplied by x minus a to the power of 0. Anything to the power of 0 is equal to 1. So the first order is f of a. Then the next order is the derivative at a divided by 1 factorial, x minus a, plus the second order. That's the derivative, so we can leave it there. Indeed, what we are saying, again, is that if I've got a function f, which is whatever, and we look at it around a, that's my a here, we are saying that f of x, or the pk of x, the Taylor approximation, the Taylor polynomial that approximates my function, at the point around of the expansion itself, it's equal to the function. On the function, the polynomial is equal to the function. We're interested what happens around the point of expansion. But at the point of expansion, it should trivially be the function itself, which is the case because if x equal a, so if we put x equal a here, all these terms will cancel. You see that this x minus a l will cancel. So we are left with the first term. So indeed, pk of a is equal to f of a. As a result, hk of a should be equal to zero, clearly. Okay. So we've got this definition for hk of x. Now we need, that's the program, we need to demonstrate that indeed its limit is equal to zero. So we've seen that fx, when x equal a, so f of a is equal to, well, f of a, that's the function itself. What we've seen mainly is pk of a is equal to f of a, so we've got 0 minus 0 on the numerator. On the denominator, we also have 0, we've got, sorry, a minus a, which is 0, to the power of k. So we've got, both on the numerator and the denominator, we've got 0. So we've got 0 over 0. That's an indeterminacy. So we need to compute it in some way. It's like when we are looking at particular case of derivative. Yeah, we have to look at how to simplify with this epsilon so that when we take the limit, it's not 0 over 0. So when we've got something which is 0 over 0, when we've got the limit f of x when x goes to, let's take a, the general case again, is equal to 0, and the limit when x goes to a of another function is equal to 0, when we got this, 0 over 0 indeterminacy, actually we can show that the limit of the ratio when x goes to a is equal to the limit of the derivative g prime of x when x goes to a. This is called, let me write this better, this is called the L'Hôpital's rule, the rule of L'Hôpital, named after this guy L'Hôpital, which means hospital in English, that's the proper name of the guy. He demonstrated that. That's actually easy to show, we are going to prove it. So that's the statement, let's demonstrate it. So we start like this, so far we don't know if it's true or not. We start at the beginning, we want to compute this, we know this, that's the assumption we are making, because this follows, eh? If, then, so we know this above. So we can say that this limit is equal to f of x minus f of a divided by g of x minus g of a. Why? Why can I write this? Because f of a and g of a, by definition, they are equal to this. That's f of a and that's g of a. That's this limit, they are equal to 0. Okay, so these two terms are 0. So I can remove 0 to any quantity. Okay, this we are going to rewrite it slightly in this form. I'm going to make a bit of room like this. Let me select a bit more selectively. Very good. And everybody now, and I add in a different color, I will add a x minus a, x minus a. So adding this blue thing, I did nothing again, yeah, because I divide both terms by the same quantity. So it's clearly exactly the same. Now we use this property that we've seen before, that the limit of fj is equal to the limit of f limit of j, if these two limits exist. Yeah, the limit of a, when the variable tends to something, is defined, it exists, it's finite, and the same for j, then the limit of the product is equal to the product of the limit. Product or inverse is the same. Yeah, it's the same. So, assuming that these things exist, and we assume this is the case because we assume for L'Hôpital rule to hold, we need to assume that f and g are differentiable, they are derivable. We need to assume that because we use them here. We use f prime and g prime, so we assume they exist. So, this limit, as I said, we can rewrite like this. The limit of the product is the product of the limit, which means that I can bring my limit like this. I can put it in the numerator. I can as well put it in the denominator. What I did here is this statement that the limit of the product, my product was, let's take a color which is not invasive, the limit of the product is equal to the product of the limit, which is the line below. Okay? But now you recognize that the numerator I've got by definition, this is f prime of a, yeah, that's the limit of f of x minus f of a, x minus a, when x goes to a, that's f prime of a, and in the denominator, g prime of a. Check again your definition of the derivative, that's the thing. But f prime of a is the limit when x goes to a of f prime of x, the same for the denominator, with j, and we do the same as before. The product of the limit is the limit of the product, so I can write this as the limit when x goes to a of f prime over g prime. And as always, if we look in red, if we look at our finite point and our starting point, we get this. Yeah, the limit of f over g, which is the left hand side here, is equal to the limit of f prime over g prime, which is the right hand side there. So we demonstrated this. We demonstrated this L'Hôpital rule. So let's come back to our Taylor theorem. We left it at computing h of k, which has this indeterminacy 0 over 0. So we are going to use L'Hôpital rule. We are going to say that the limit when x goes to a of f x minus pk x divided by x minus a to the power of k, yeah? Let's copy it to be sure and copy there, so divided by x minus a k is equal to the limit of the derivative. So let's look at the derivative of the denominator, for instance, is like this. Of course, we differentiate with x as a variable, and then we've got f prime of x minus the first order derivative of this polynomial. Right, now what do we have? So this pk, we could find it again, but maybe it's simpler to just write it again. So it's like this, fl a divided by l factorial x minus a l. If I look at the first order derivative of this, we will get this term here stays the same, yeah? This I don't differentiate, it's constant, so I just copy it. I'm writing it again because you see that every time I try to copy with this tool, I spend half an hour. The derivative is there. This derivative of this term. Okay, so I can write it actually in green. That's L, x minus a, L minus 1. Okay, now the sum that was starting at 0, we can start at 1 actually now. Because the one which was constant, x minus a, 0 is a constant, is killed by the derivative. So it's 0, it's cancelled, so we can start at 1. Like this, we don't have negative power there, which would be wrong. So that's the result. So if we look at this at a, at the value of a, we'll get, let's expand this thing, so that's f prime of a divided by 1 factorial, l is 1 here, x minus a to the power of 0, which is 1. So that's f prime of 1 plus f second of a over 2 factorial, 2 x minus a, 2 minus 1. And we carry on. And here, all the other terms that are in the ellipsis, they will cancel because of this x equal a. Yeah, x equal a. So that cancel here, it will cancel here with the square root 4. So all these terms cancel, and we are left with this result. P prime of f is f prime of a. And f prime of a, which we have there, this f prime, f prime of a minus p prime of a, when I'm doing a because x goes to a, so if I look at what happens when I put a inside, I will get again 0, yeah? F prime of a minus p prime k of a, which is f prime of a. So f prime of a minus f prime of a is 0, and here as well, 0 a minus a is 0, so we've got again 0 over 0. So we use this L'Hôpital rule to get rid of the 0 over 0, and then we are again with 0 over 0. So we don't seem to be making lots of progress. But let's do it again. We've got 0 over 0. We apply L'Hôpital's rule. The same thing will happen this time with f prime prime a minus pk prime prime a, which you can check, will also be f prime prime a. So we'll get again, on the denominator, we'll get k minus 1, x minus a, so a minus a, 0, to the power of k minus 2, so again 0 over 0. So we'll keep having a lot of 0 over 0 indeterminacy until we cannot differentiate this, because that's a kth order polynomial, so if we iterate at some point, we will not get this this constant term. We'll get something else. So that's what we are going to do. We are going to differentiate this quantity a number of times, which is, let's do it a second time if you want. Second time, so as before, this term is the same, so actually this time we'll copy it to see if it's true that it takes more time or not. Okay, it doesn't change the constant. Then here, we've got the one of before, we've got this L, because we are differentiating this, and the second order derivative of this is like taking the first order derivative of this one. I hope you are following my arrows. So that's this L, L minus 1. So I will put the L that corresponds to each other. Blue, for instance. Yeah? I hope that you can see what's going on. X minus A, L minus 2. Yeah, I took the derivative. And here, as before, now we are starting from 2. Yeah, because the L minus 2, when this is 1, that cancel because of this term. You cancel the new constant. If it's not clear with the abstract notation of sigma, write all the terms. Yeah? Expand your Taylor polynomial in full. Take a particular case, for instance, k equal 5, and see that the second order derivative cancels this, so we can start the sum at l equal 2. So we can carry on like this until we arrive to pk. We are going to the k minus 1th derivative, in which case here we've got, when it was k, we got, when it was 2, sorry, here. These two I can write like this if you want. And this I can write it as 1. So you see that here I've got 1, which is 1. Here I got 2, which is 2. I got k minus 1. So here that gives me k minus 1 over k. This is always the same, constant, this doesn't move. Here I've got L minus 1. L minus, so what do we have here? We have 2, we had L is minus 1 plus 1, 2 is minus 2 plus 1, so here I've got L minus K. I've got L minus K minus 1 plus 1. Okay? K minus 1 plus 1 is K, so it's L minus K. Then we've got X minus A, the derivative, and the same here, we've got L minus K minus 1, so plus 1. Yeah, I can put L minus, in parentheses, K minus 1, that makes L minus K plus 1, if I remove the parentheses. So that's our expression. Okay. And now this one we can actually expand, because now we keep the sigma notation to be general, but this sigma notation is almost more bulky, more to write in this abstract compact form than to actually write the full sum. Why? Because we actually, if we look at the boundaries, we actually have two terms. You got the term k minus 1 and the term k. So if we look at the, if we expand now this sum for the case where L is equal to k minus 1, we've got k minus 1 a divided by k minus 1 factorial. Here we've got k minus 1 to k minus 1 minus k. So that cancel. K minus 1 minus k. And we should be left with k factorial, k minus 1 factorial. Is it the case? We are putting L equal k minus 1. So that's
k minus 1, k minus 1 minus 1, k minus 2. We should be left with k minus 1 factorial. X minus a, L minus, so let's do it slowly. We replace L by k minus 1. It's k minus 1 minus k plus 1. Cancel the minus k and cancel here. So this is 0 here. Okay? So that's the case for the k minus 1. That's this one. I will put it, that was k, I will put it in orange this case, because it corresponds to the lower part of the sum.
And the upper part of the sum, I will put it in red. That's when we got k. So that's the kth derivative of a divided by k factorial. And then we've got
k minus 1, L minus k, so k minus 0, so that's 0, x minus a, L minus k, so that's a minus k plus 1, that's k minus k plus 1, that's x minus a. So I think I'm missing the plus 1 here for some reason. L minus 1, L minus k, it's missing the plus 1 here. So that here I should get 0, and here I should get 1, which cancels this k.
So that's the red part. Checking the note. I'm putting now the notes that are on your canvas page so that you can check the exact result, which I don't seem to have at hand there. But anyway, so the point is that this pk, k minus 1 of x, is the sum of two terms. One is fk minus 1 a plus fk a x minus a. That's the result. Because here we've got 1 and here we've got 0. And we cancel the denominator, one that includes the one that starts at 2 and the other that starts at 1. So we don't miss this term here because it's 1 anyway, which is the one that is missing in this expansion. So that's the result at the end of the day. There might be, sorry, a bit of a hiatus there when I'm writing it down, but that's the idea. If you do it cleanly, if you follow the notes, that's what it should give you. Okay, so this we are doing for L'Hospital's rules. Yeah, let's come back to our definition of HK, which was there. we need to go very far above. So I copy it there, that RHK, and we differentiate this k minus 1 times. Go back down here. So the limit of this when x goes to a is equal of the limit of the kth derivative minus the kth derivative divided by the kth derivative of the denominator. Okay, be careful with notation. Here is the kth power and here is the kth derivative in parentheses, yeah, because we are taking here as well the kth derivative, and here is again the order of the polynomial. So this k, they mean different things each time. Here we have applied L'Hôpital rule k minus 1 times. I want it k minus 1 actually, that's k minus 1. So everywhere I replace by k minus 1. Let me remove this parenthesis. K minus 1. It would also be correct with k, but at k we might get another trivial result, which is that we come back to 0 over 0 indeterminacy. We have to stop at this. This is a good point to stop because in the denominator, if we do this, you will get k minus 1. We have to apply this a given number of time, x minus a, and then we stop at x minus a because we have lowered the we have lowered this index sufficient number of time, which leaves us with x minus a. I believe. We'll see what it needs to be. X minus a times 1. Okay, so this I can replace by k factorial. That's what we get in the denominator. Denominator is actually the easy part. Now let's look at the numerator. So the k minus 1 derivative at x, we leave it. And next, now we, in green, we will substitute this term, which we computed there. That's the bulk of the calculation, is to compute this term that we put in green. So that's minus f k minus 1 a, this term here, minus, because that's a plus, the second term, which is the kth derivative x minus a. Okay, I just substituted. And we got the limit there. Yeah, let's not forget that we are looking a limit eventually. So we put the limit there, remove the little things that are too much. Okay, what do we do with this now? The k factorial I can put outside. Okay, because that just rescaled the limit, so I can put it outside, no problem. I can break this in two, I will copy it and try to work on this quantity. We should not lose track of what we are trying to demonstrate. I'm always bothered by this equal, never aware where it should be. It's a big step there, sorry. Let's try to bring it back. Okay. So, here, there is something clear that we can do, is to break this. So you see that this term here, I will cancel with this one. So we can break this sum here and remove this term. Okay, I put this outside. This limit that initially was for everybody, yeah? Now this doesn't depend on x, you see it's a constant. This is a which is inside. So again, limit of the sum, if the two terms exist, that's the sum of the limit. So I can actually put the limit like this. And now what do we have inside? I think you see it. That's the limit of f k minus 1 x minus f k minus 1 a or x minus a. That's, I'm going to write it, make sure that you agree, that's the kth derivative of a. Here, because this is in front, when I break the thing, I shouldn't forget that I've got, I put it in red, I've got this in front. I shouldn't forget my rules of elementary algebra, so I've got this always. So do you agree with this? Just I put there, and we shouldn't forget this term. And then our result is complete. Okay. What I'm seeing is we did this so far. Let's take the yellow again. What is inside this big k curly brackets, that's the definition of the derivative, this limit. Yeah. Indeed, if we call g the k minus 1 derivative, you see that you've got the limit when x goes to a, gx minus ga divided by x minus a. This, by definition, is g prime of a. But g being a, being f k minus 1 times, that's the k minus 1 derivative, if we differentiate once more, this is f k, okay, which I put there. Which is also this term there, the term that we had there. Yeah. Therefore, this is clearly 0. Yeah. So all this work to arrive there, is it bad? No, no, it's not bad, because if you remember, I hope you didn't hold your breath all this time of the derivation, because it was quite a long one. But that's what we wanted to show. So here we can put quoderat demonstrandum, what we had to show. Yeah, that the limit of hk of x when x goes to a is equal to 0. That's what we showed. Yeah, the limit of hk of x when x goes to a is equal to 0. That's the proof there. That shows that the remainder of our Taylor expansion goes to 0 faster than the kth order term of the Taylor polynomial. That's what makes this Taylor polynomial really useful. Okay, so it's a long proof. I kind of hesitated there in the calculation of these prefactors, but they are just to follow. It is a bit tough to follow if the notes are not enough. By all means, look at the particular case, yeah, like the fifth order, the third order, fourth order, or seventh order case, and check that it all goes like this, and then reconstruct the proof. It's not such a straightforward proof that you can completely absorb it in one sitting by looking at me. I was going to say do it. I should say maybe more correctly, struggling to do it, because you see that sometimes it requires to hold one's breath. But that's the proof. That's the proof, and I think it's more or less convincingly done on the paper. So study it carefully. Most importantly, I mean, it's very nice if you can let it sink and come at peace with the proof and say, yeah, I understand, I agree, all the steps, I understand that we wanted to demonstrate that this remainder term of the Taylor expansion goes to zero. The limit brings us on something that goes to zero in the numerator, zero on the denominator, so it's zero over zero. When it's the case, we can use this L'Hospital rule. L'Hospital's rule says that the limit of this is equal to the limit of the derivatives, but we have got the same, so we derivate again. The same, so we derivate again, the same. If we do it k minus 1 times, it's not the 0 over 0 anymore. We arrive at something final that we can simplify. And at the end, we've got indeed that the limit is the fk of a minus fk of a, which cancels. So that proves that the limit is 0. Okay. But more importantly than the proof itself, so the proof is important because it's mathematical proof, and at least some statements, especially important one like this Taylor theorem, you need to prove and convince yourself that you are happy with the proof, or maybe ideally be able yourself to demonstrate it, to conduct the proof. But more importantly is to be able to use this Taylor theorem, yeah, which means that you should know this formula. Where is it? In this box, for instance? Yeah, this one. The Maclaurin, or we don't put the Taylor in a box? Okay, let's put it in a box. Let's go at the end. And now that we demonstrated it, we can write it in full glory, in dark green, for instance. So f of x around a plus, so we'll write both the general case and the particular case. So it's f prime of a x minus a plus f second of a x minus a squared divided by 2 plus f three of a x minus a cubed divided by 6 plus so on and so forth. Generic term is f of k, now I come back to k because that goes to not to infinity. Okay, let's put L. So that we've got, on top of that, I put it, this goes as the derivative. So let's put L, goes from 0 to k, because we'll stop at k. So here we put L, evaluated at 0, x minus a, L divided by L factorial. That's the Taylor polynomial, plus the remainder. The reminder is whatever term, actually there are expressions in the note, I put you some results that tell you as well what kind of exact result we can put for the reminder, but for us it's not important. We just want to say that this is something, x minus a, that goes to zero as x goes to 0. Remember, this is a notation for the limit when x goes to 0, the function is equal to. Yeah? That's the definition for, I write it again, the limit when x goes to a of hk of x is equal to 0. Be careful, it's a narrow, yet an equal. Okay, so this thing goes to 0 faster than this term, which is the last order term of our Taylor polynomial. So, as promised, let's remove this and let's put our Taylor polynomial in a red box. That's something you need to know, this Taylor polynomial. And more importantly, the Maclaurin series, which is a case where x, sorry, when a is equal to 0, because we often expand around x equal to 0. So that's the most important, and the proof itself is to understand what it says, to be able to write it correctly, to understand where is the variable. Variable is here, and we understand where is the point around which we expand, which is there, that's A, and understand the order at which we make the expansion, which is this one, and understand what are the quantities or concepts that are involved, which is the Lth order derivative at a given point, and then the factorial and the Poisson series. So the fact that we've got the Poisson series here, it means that indeed we are expanding our function in terms of a polynomial. So very, really useful result, and that starts to bring us into this notion to which we are going little by little, this notion of vector space, of linear space, which is that any object of a space of function, any function which is complicated, we can write as a linear combination of basis object, basis vector. So in this case, our basis would be the monomial, this power function. They are the bricks of our house, and with these bricks we can build everything. Any complicated function that involves logarithm, cosine, trigonometric function, arctangent, reciprocal, whatever, square root, whatever you want to put in there, we can always decompose this in terms of our basis vector by making a linear superposition, which means adding them and rescaling them. The rescaling is this alpha k in our Poisson series. Oops, don't write with the lipstick. It's alpha k xk. Okay, so here we've got our bricks and here we've got our coefficients. The Taylor polynomial give you the formula for this coefficient. It tells you, oops, I'm taking too much, I'm putting the bricks. It's telling you the alpha k are like this, the xk are like this. Okay, we'll conclude this by showing you one case of a function to which this Taylor polynomial doesn't apply. This Taylor expansion, Taylor decomposition doesn't work. I'm not sure it's good pedagogy to finish with an example to show you that what we did doesn't work. But it's important for you to know that sometimes it doesn't work. In physics, most of the time, it will work. Yeah. Again, we call them analytic functions. They are precisely functions for which the Taylor expansion gives the function itself, where these things work. This thing in the red books works for analytic function. I will give you one example of a function, namely this one. It's an important function, we'll see it. You will see it next year in connection with the Picard theorem to show you something very beautiful result of complex analysis, so when x will be not real like now but complex. But so far, we'll use it to show you that this is a case where the function is not analytic. So here at x equals 0, we would divide by 0. So we have to say that what happens if x equals 0. So if it's not equal to 0, it's defined like this. If it is equal to 0, x, the function is equal to 0. Okay, we could plot this function. You can do it. It's a function like this. I'm taking two different colors. It's a beautiful function that is like this. Then it's flat there and it grows like this. So let me put this axis there. Okay. That's the axis of 0. Okay, that's 0. Okay, so that's 1 over x squared. It's not this function. This is the Gaussian, very important function, which is well-behaved. It's like this. This one is very weird because it's flat there. It's this flatness, this very uncanny flatness, that makes the function non-analytic. So how do we show that it's non-analytic? Well, we can show that if we apply this Taylor formula, we compute this derivative, then we don't converge to this. We converge to something else, namely we converge to the function which is identically 0. So let's compute the derivative of this. This is the derivative of this, where f is the exponential and g is this function we want, is minus 1 over x squared. So this is f prime, which is the exponential, composited with our function, and the derivative of this function, g prime. So g prime is of the type 1 over u, so that's minus u prime over u square. So it's minus minus, that cancels the minus. U prime is 2x, and u square is x4. So we can cancel the x, we are left with 2 and cube here. Okay, so that's the derivative there. And we'd like to show that this derivative, if we apply the Taylor formula, we should get that f of x, so exponential minus 1 x squared, is equal to f of 0, which is 0 by definition here, that's f of 0, plus f prime at 0 times x minus 0, because that's Maclaurin actually that we are doing, because a is equal to 0, to the power of 1. And then we should look at the second order derivative at 0 squared divided by 2, and carry on. So we have to look at f prime of 0. F prime is this, that's this function, f prime. And we are back to this exponential minus 1 over s squared, divided by x cubed, so it's even less defined. So we have to compute, f prime from the definition. F prime of x is the limit when x goes to 0 of f of x minus f of 0, which is 0, remember, putting another arrow, divided by x minus 0. Yeah, so that's exponential minus 1 over x squared divided by x. So here we'll do a change of variable. We'll use x equal 1 over big X, for instance. We change the variable. So when x goes to 0, 1 over big X has to go to infinity. Yeah, so that 1 over big X is the X that goes to 0. Then we've got exponential minus change of variable. That makes x squared divided by 1 over x. So this 1 over x goes in the numerator. That's x exponential x squared. And I shouldn't forget to put my limit. Okay, so it's funny because now we inverted. We've got the what was in the denominator before is in the numerator, and the function by this change of variable is in the denominator. Right, so we've got x over x exponential x squared. When x goes to infinity, in the numerator we go to infinity, in the denominator we go to infinity. So infinity over infinity. That's the type of indeterminacy of the L'Hôpital rule. So we can use the L'Hôpital trick. We can look at the derivative. Derivative of x is 1. What is the derivative of x squared? We compute using this, that's exponential x squared, 2x. Yeah. If you do it fast enough, you get used to this sort of stuff. So that's 2x exponential x squared when x goes to infinity. And this time we can compute because the numerator goes to 1, the denominator goes to infinity, 1 over infinity is 0. So f prime of x at 0, f prime of 0 is 0. Okay? So therefore this term is equal to 0. So we've got 0 plus 0 plus, we need to go to the second order term. I let you do it because we are starting to spend a lot of time doing this, and the idea is exactly the same. You can use the L'Hôpital rule, so you have to differentiate this again. You will see that you arrive again to a 0 over 0 type of indeterminacy. You need to apply the definition of the derivative as we did it on the second order term, and you can show it by recurrence. It's called recurrence or induction. It means that you assume the form at a given order, and you show that it's transpose or generalize to the next order to show that fk of 0 is equal to 0. Okay, so the Taylor expansion of exponential minus x squared will give you 0 plus 0 plus 0 plus 0 to all order, which means that your x minus ak, this term doesn't go to 0 this time. This term is actually the full function divided by this. That's the topology I was saying about. So it breaks down. Okay, so this function here is non-analytical. You've got, it's not analytical at this point, it's analytical everywhere else. You can check that if you look here, actually the function is not so flat at this point, it starts to bulge a little bit, so you can actually break it or reconstruct it in terms of polynomial, an infinite series of polynomial. But at zero you can't. At zero it's so flat that there is no polynomial that can bring it up. So that's one example which is nice to keep in mind, because in mathematics it's such a complex and rich field that there is always an exception to something. Yeah, the Taylor theorem, the Taylor expansion, doesn't work with absolutely everything. It only works with what are called the analytic function. That's actually the definition of analytic function. Okay, this being said, I leave it with you to practice this. It's very important. So not only your understanding of the proof, but also your application of the Taylor formula to various types of functions. Here I put you in the lecture notes list of functions that you are more than strongly invited. I don't want to say that you are compelled or summoned, but please work them out because they're important and they will be a good excuse for you to practice derivative. Yeah, like this is not like random exercise where we give you really stupid questions, really stupid functions to differentiate. You got one that's actually important, and the iteration of this increasing orders of derivative for the Taylor expansion, they bring you to compute things that are relevant. This is relevant because we need the result. You will need to know actually all this on the tip of your fingers, because all the time you are going to use this Taylor expansion to approximate complicated functions in terms of their polynomial versions to some given order.